Thank you for joining me on the sixth episode of The LAVA Spurt, the 28 pages later edition, where we talk about the classified 28-page report finally released by Congress and President Obama.
Welcome to The LAVA Spurt, the weekly offshoot of The LAVA Flow, channeling the flow of information to the libertarian, anarcho-capitalist, voluntarist, and agorist community. Brought to you by my per-episode donors. Thank you. Here's your host, Roger Paxton.
The 28 pages secret document was part of a 2002 congressional investigation of the September 11th attacks and has been classified since the report's completion. This document has been big news for a long time, pretty much since it was made secret 14 years ago. But now it's been released, and it says pretty much what everybody expected it to say, that men in Saudi Arabian government aided and abetted the 9/11 terrorists. The report opens with this statement, quote, finding, while in the United States, some of the September 11th hijackers were in contact with and received support from individuals who may be connected to the Saudi government. So what information does this document actually reveal? It does reveal a lot of new information. First of all, a telephone number found in the phone book of Al-Qaeda operative Abu Zubaydah, who was captured in Pakistan in March 2002, was for an Aspen, Colorado corporation that managed the, quote, affairs of the Colorado residents of the Saudi ambassador Bandar, the documents show. For what purpose did Abu Zubaydah have this number? Why would some random Al-Qaeda terrorist have a number that would get him in touch with a Saudi ambassador and a Saudi prince? And yes, Bandar was also a Saudi prince. As the New York Post's Paul Sperry said, quote, the takeaway that was shocking to me was the fact that we had Abu Zubaydah having phone contacts, unlisted phone contacts, in his possession when he was captured in Pakistan after 9/11. This was a senior Al-Qaeda operative of the Aspen residence, the chalet, for Prince Bandar, Saudi Prince Bandar. This is an unlisted number, tied to a security company that no one even knew about. They weren't even on the radar. It took 2 months for the FBI to even run this to ground. Who the hell was the security company, and who did this phone number belong to? Further, Osama Bosnan, who the documents identify as a financial supporter of two of the 9/11 hijackers in San Diego, received money directly from Bandar, and Bosnan's wife also got money from Prince Bandar's wife. Quote, on at least one occasion, the documents show Bosnan received a check directly from Prince Bandar's account. According to the FBI, on May 14, 1998, Bosnan cashed a check from Bandar in the amount of $15,000. Bosnan's wife also received at least one check directly from Bandar. The pages also cite a CIA report that indicates Bosnan received, quote, a significant amount of cash from an unidentified member of the Saudi royal family in a 2002 Houston meeting, 7 months after the attacks that killed nearly 3,000 people. Bosnan's wife also received a monthly stipend of $2,000 every month from Prince Bandar's wife, Princess Haifa. The total money the Bosnans received from the Saudi prince was around $75,000 or more. Keep in mind that Prince Bandar had such close ties to the family of George W. Bush that he was given the nickname Bandar Bush, the fourth Bush brother. Circumstantial evidence? Sure. But enough for any rational man to see a connection here. Who is Osama Bosnan, the guy who was receiving money from Bandar Bush or Prince Bandar? He worked at the Saudi Arabia Education Ministry in Washington. He also hosted a party in 1992 for the Blind Sheikh, a convicted plotter in the World Trade Center attack in 1993. Egyptian Omar Abdel Rahman, the Blind Sheikh, received a life sentence for that attack. Also, according to the 28 pages, Bosnan spoke of bin Laden, quote, as if he were a god. This guy was clearly a terrorist sympathizer and a financier. Why was he and his wife receiving direct money from a Saudi ambassador and prince and his wife? And there are other connections between highly suspected Saudi intelligence officer Omar al-Bayoumi, who was in frequent contact with the emir at the Saudi Ministry of Defense and received a paycheck from a Saudi aviation company in the United States but never did any work for them, and two of the hijackers, al-Hamzi and al-Midhar, Albayumi set them up in an apartment in San Diego. He also helped them with Social Security paperwork and information about flying courses. He also introduced them to Imam Anwar al-Awlaki, who was later to be named the, quote, Bin Laden of the Internet, and was killed in an American drone strike in Yemen. Albayumi was listed in pre-9/11 FBI files as a Saudi intelligence agency and was a frequent visitor to the Saudis' Washington Embassy and consulate in Los Angeles. Fihad al-Thumari, a jihadist cleric of the King Fahd Mosque in Los Angeles and a Saudi consular official, also gave support to the two Saudi terrorists. An FBI document in 2012 concluded that al-Thumari, quote, immediately assigned an individual to take care of al-Hamzi and al-Midhar during their time in Los Angeles. Albayumi acknowledged to U.S. investigators that he had an hour-long meeting with Fahad al-Thumari, an official of the Ministry of Islamic Affairs, who he described as his spiritual mentor at the Saudi consulate in Los Angeles the same day that he met al-Hamzi and al-Midhar. 2 years later, al-Thumari was stripped of his diplomatic immunity and deported from the U.S. because of his suspected terrorist links. While I'll be the first to admit that there's no smoking gun in this 28-page document, as many have alleged, there is quite a lot of circumstantial evidence about financing and logistics that go from the Saudi royal family, Prince Bandar and his wife, through Saudi consulate employees, al-Thumari, to the agent handlers, Bosnan and al-Bayumi, to some of the 9/11 hijackers, Khalid al-Midhar and Nawaf al-Hamzi. So with all of this information out now, the big question is, why did Obama finally allow their release after all of this time? Well, this is a promise that Obama made when running for president to the families of 9/11 victims, that he would release these pages. He wanted to keep at least one of his campaign promises before he got out of office. I assume, anyway. Too bad he hasn't shut down Guantanamo or stopped bombing brown people also. But that might be a little bit too much to ask. Until next time, keep striking the root.
Thank you for listening to The Lava Flow at thelavaflow.com. Don't miss an episode. Subscribe now at thelavaflow.com/subscribe. This has been a Pax Libertas Productions podcast.